friends, I'm Dr. Shonali, and today we are discussing the AIIMS November recall 2019, the recent examination. So without wasting any further time, let us begin. So coming on to the first question, this one here. So the following instruments are used in what? All right. So identify these instruments, these set of instruments. One here is the IR spatula. Now I have shown this in the classes as well. I've shown it in the test and discussions as well. This instrument is the IR spatula. And alongside the IR spatula, this instrument here is the endocervical brush. And both of these instruments are used in taking a pap smear. So this was a simple direct question. These instruments are used in taking a pap smear. Now this end of the IR spatula is rotated on the ectocervix, all right, and cells are scraped off from the ectocervix, from the transformation zone actually on the ectocervix, and then a slide is made, and that slide is not allowed to air dry, so it is immediately after making the slide immediately put in the fixative, all right, and the fixative for pap smear, the fixative for the pap smear, which is the conventional pap smear where slides are made in this way using the IR spatula, is 95% ethanol. Okay. Apart from that, another slide is made via the endocervical brush. So endocervical, as the name suggests, this brush end here, it has fine bristles, okay, and this is inserted into the endocervix, and it is again rotated by 360 degrees, and endocervical sampling is taken by this endocervical brush. So a separate slide is made. So nowadays when we do a conventional pap smear, we make two slides, one from the transformation zone. This takes the sample from the transformation zone on the ectocervix, and the endocervical brush helps us take the sample from the endocervical region. So we take two samples, make two slides, and we do not allow the slide to air dry. Immediately put the slides in the fixative, and the fixative for pap smear is 95% ethanol. All right. What are the other three tests mentioned here? VIA stands for visual inspection with acetic acid. WILI stands for visual inspection with Lugol's iodine. So simply in this cases, what happens in both these cases, we don't use any, you know, sophisticated instruments like spatula or brushes or anything. Simply open the vagina and look at the cervix using a speculum, and then, you know, dab the cervix with either a 5% acetic acid. So for visual inspection with acetic acid, talking about the other options in the question, for VIA, that is visual inspection with acetic acid, what we use is a 5% acetic acid to dab the cervix, and any white area, abnormal white area, can be looked and can be biopsied. So that abnormal white area means that there is VIA positive. So the abnormal area in this situation is going to be white. Similarly, WILI stands for visual inspection with Lugol's iodine. Okay, and in this case, the abnormal area does not stain brown. So normal vaginal epithelium stains brown with Lugol's iodine, but abnormal area is going to be yellow in color, and the normal area is going to stain brown. So that also helps us identify an abnormal looking area. Both these VIA and VIALI, villi, VIA and villi, they are good screening tests in low resource settings. These are the screening tests in low resource settings. Both these are used in low resource settings. All right. And then the fourth option of the question had LBC. What is LBC? LBC stands for liquid based cytology. So liquid based cytology is just a method of doing the pap smear testing only, right? So the pap smear that we described before this was the conventional pap smear. There's another way to analyze the pap smear, that is via the liquid based cytology. In this case, the only difference is that we don't use a slide, we don't make a slide, but the sample is taken via a rocket endocervical brush, and that is, you know, the brush is dipped into the fixative, and then the brush is also broken off into the fixative, and that creates the vaginal cells that are thus scraped from the ectocervix and the endocervical region. They are they are lying in a suspension of fixative, and what we get is a very clear slide where each cell can be seen separately. So liquid based cytology is again a cytological test, just like the pap smear. The only difference is how we do the testing, all right? So it is just another form of pap smear. So the pap smear that we described using the IR spatula is a conventional pap smear, and then we have another modification to it, which is liquid based cytology. So coming on to the next question, in which they are asking you the IV loading dose of magnesium sulfate prophylaxis and preeclampsia or eclampsia. Now, this is like AIIMS upping their game, right? So they're asking you the clinical question. How is it a clinical question? See, we have mugged up, some memorized the dosages of magnesium sulfate, the regimes of magnesium sulfate, but this is something which is not taught in textbooks. This is something which you do not find in textbooks. You do not find in guidebooks. This is something that you find in the clinics. This is something that you will know if you have loaded the magnesium sulfate injection and given to the patient. This is something that you will know if you have seen your SRs or postgraduates or teachers give the instruction to the sister how to load the magnesium sulfate injection. So let me tell you in brief about the loading dose of magnesium prophylaxis. Let's talk about the Pritchard regime, for instance, which is the most common regime. So the Pritchard regime tells us that when we give the loading dose, we have to give a total of 14 grams. Out of this 14 grams, 4 grams is IV given in a 20% solution, and the rest 10 grams is IM, which is 50% solution. Okay, so 10 grams is like distributed as 5 gram in one buttock and 5 gram in the other buttock, and 4 gram is the IV dose. Now they are asking you, how do we give this IV loading dose for magnesium sulfate prophylaxis? Now the magnesium sulfate vial that is available in our hospitals, in our pharmacies, everywhere, so it's quite universal all over India. I've worked many places, it is the same magnesium sulfate vial. That one vial of magnesium sulfate contains 2 ml solution, and that 2 ml solution has 1 gram of magnesium sulfate. Weight by volume is 50%. Okay, so in that one vial, in that 2 ml solution, there is 1 gram of magnesium sulfate, right? So the concentration of magnesium sulfate in that 2 ml vial, in that 2 ml solution, is 50%. Now if I have to give magnesium sulfate as a 20% solution, I'll have to dilute this magnesium sulfate to make it a 20% solution, right? But in that solution, I need 4 grams of magnesium sulfate, right? 4 gram is the amount that is required. So for 4 gram, I need 4 vials. 4 vials means 8 ml is the magnesium sulfate. So to give 4 grams of magnesium sulfate, I will need 4 vials. So 4 vials will make it 8 ml of magnesium sulfate. But this 8 ml of magnesium sulfate that I have loaded now, 8 ml, is 50% weight by volume. I have to make it 20% weight by volume. Now, using simple mathematics, unitary method calculation, I will have a 20% weight by volume solution if the total volume of that solution is 20 ml. Okay, so to make up the extra volume, I add 12 ml of NS. I dilute it in 12 ml of NS because I have calculated that to achieve a weight by volume concentration of 20%, I need to have a solution which is the whole quantity of the solution should be 20 ml. So I diluted the remaining volume 20 minus 8, 12 ml of NS. So the answer is 8 ml of magnesium sulfate plus 12 ml of NS. That is how the IV loading dose is given. Okay, when we have to give the IV loading dose in case of a Zuspan regime where the whole regime is IV, there also we make the solution 20%. Whenever we have to give IV, we make the solution 20% by using this formula, by using this principle. And the other important thing is when giving the IM dosages of magnesium sulfate, there is no dilution required. Simply it is already 50% solution. That 2 ml vial already has a 50% solution. So if you want to give 10 gram IM, then we'll have to have 10 vials, right? So in that case, we don't need to dilute when giving the IM injection. We need to dilute when we give the IV injection. And this is something that is classic, this is something that is very clinical based. We simply ask the sister to load 4 vials of magnesium sulfate, and she has to be taught how to do the dilution. It just has to come at a spinal level to all of us that it is 4 vials is 4 grams, and then I have to dilute it with 12 ml of NS to make it full 20 ml solution. That will ultimately be a 20% solution. Okay, so this is about question number 3. To the next question, question number 3. This is a simple question, often asked bacterial vaginosis question, often asked in various forms. So a 26 years patient complain of foul smelling gray white discharge. Here's your first clue. Diagnosed to be Gardnerella vaginalis, that they are mentioning it to you. Gardnerella vaginalis infection, that means they're talking about bacterial vaginosis. And in bacterial vaginosis, what happens? The lactobacilli, they are replaced by the gram negative rods. It is a mixture of gram negative rods. The most prominent among those gram negative rods is Gardnerella vaginalis. Apart from Gardnerella vaginalis, there is ureaplasma, there could be mobilincus, and so on and so forth. So there can be many other gram negative rods also, but predominantly Gardnerella vaginalis. Microscopic findings are suggestive of what? That means if you were to take that gray white discharge and look it up in the microscope, that is on saline microscopy or a wet smear, what are you going to find? We are going to find bacteria adherent to the lining vaginal epithelial cells. So we are going to see the epithelial cell, and on the lining the bacteria are adherent, making the appearance of the cell as if it had a very fuzzy irregular outline. And these cells are called as clue cells. Right? So we have studied time and again that clue cells are seen in bacterial vaginosis, clue cells are seen in Gardnerella vaginalis infection, and that is what they have asked, but in a different format. What are these clue cells? You are going to see bacteria adherent to lining vaginal epithelial cells. You will not see bacilli arranged in chain forms, no. You will not see bacteria engulfed by macrophages. Where will you see bacteria engulfed by macrophages? That means intracellular bacteria. Intracellular bacteria are going to be seen in gonorrhea. Like example, gonorrhea. If there are cluster forms, that is bacteria in cocci, you know, cluster forms that are streptococci, staphylococci, group of bacilli arranged in chain forms. These are not what we are seeing. What we are seeing is bacteria adherent to lining vaginal epithelial cells called as clue cells. So it's a very simple question. You just had to think maybe a little more. Moving on to the next question. A 16-year-old girl walks into your clinic and asks for CA cervix vaccine. And which is the CA cervix vaccine? Very simple direct question. It is Gardasil. Gardasil is the vaccine which has now almost replaced Cervarix. All right. And in India, we are still waiting for the 9-valent vaccine. Okay, it has come up. So there are 3 vaccines for cervical cancer. And we have the Cervarix. We have the Gardasil. And we have the 9-valent. This is the newest one. Okay. Question on the 9-valent vaccine was asked in previous year AIIMS examination. The Cervarix contains only 16 and 18 types. All right. Only 16 and 18 types of HPV particles. And Gardasil contains 16, 18, 6 and 11 also. Right. So, Gardasil is the one which offers protection against warts also. Gardasil offers protection against warts as well, okay, and it is preferably given to young girls, adolescent girls aged 11 to 14 years. Okay, preferably given at this age group, but if it's a 16-year-old girl, doesn't matter, we can still give it to her as long as she's not sexually active, all right? So, the effect of vaccine is going to be there. So, it is preferably given at the age of, between the age of 11 to 14 years, but yes, it can be given any time between 9 to 26 years. So, it's not like, you know, somebody has crossed 14 and she should be denied the vaccine, right? So, you can give it between 9 to 26 years as well. So, Gardasil is that vaccine. The timing of giving the vaccine is the same for Cervarix as well as 9-valent. That is not changed. The only difference is that Gardasil has 16, 18, 6 and 11, right? And it offers protection against warts as well. The 9-valent one, apart from containing 16, 18, 6, 11, has other 5 high-risk HPV types as well. So, 9-valent will have 9 HPV genotypes will be covered in the 9-valent. So, 4 these plus 5 more high-risk HPV types are included in the 9-valent type of vaccine. Moving on to the next question. Okay, another bacterial vaginosis question. The drug of choice for bacterial vaginosis in pregnancy. So, let me talk about bacterial vaginosis in pregnancy. Bacterial vaginosis in pregnancy. A lot of you people got confused between these two options, whether it was metronidazole, whether it was clindamycin, all right. Now, the drug of choice for bacterial vaginosis in pregnancy is the same as in non-pregnant women, that is metronidazole, okay. None of the antibiotics are absolutely safe in pregnancy. First of all, let us clear this, okay. None of the drugs, okay. All the drugs, they will come into the breast milk, they will cross the placenta. So, what we do is, you know, we analyze the risk-benefit ratio, right? According to that analysis of risk-benefit ratio, it has been seen that it is good to treat bacterial vaginosis in pregnancy, but only in symptomatic women. And for that, we use the same drug that we used in non-pregnant women, that is metronidazole. Some of you might be thinking, then what do we do in the first trimester? That that is the trimester which is at most risk for teratogenesis, what do we do then? Do we give them metronidazole? Do we give them clindamycin? If we can give metronidazole, we can give clindamycin also, right? So though both these drugs are, you know, we have to be cautious giving them orally in the first trimester. So it is not about the type of drug in first trimester. It is more about the route of administration first trimester. So if I have to treat bacterial vaginosis in pregnancy in first trimester, let's say, then I will still use metronidazole, but yes, I will prefer to give by the vaginal route rather than the oral route, all right? So the recommendations are that the first choice of drug is metronidazole. Clindamycin is an alternative drug. Okay, clindamycin is an alternative drug to metronidazole. The drug of choice is metronidazole in the same way, 500 milligrams BD for 7 days. This is can be given orally. And let's say if I have to treat a bacterial vaginosis in first trimester, I will prefer the vaginal route. So we have vaginal gels of metronidazole, we have vaginal pessaries of metronidazole, they can be used instead of the oral medication, all right? So the difference between trimester wise treating for bacterial vaginosis is not in the drug that is used, it is in the mode of administration, the route of administration of that very same drug, all right? Now, bacterial vaginosis in pregnancy, two other important points, that bacterial vaginosis in pregnancy, what are the risks of bacterial vaginosis in pregnancy? The risks are of preterm labor. The risks are of preterm premature rupture of membranes. And the risk is of endometritis. These are the broad risks of broad risk of bacterial vaginosis in pregnancy, right? So, does that mean that should we screen all women with bacterial vaginosis in pregnancy? No. Another checkpoint is there is no routine screening. There is no routine screening for bacterial vaginosis in pregnant women. Okay, so it's not like we will screen for bacterial vaginosis in all pregnant women. All right, there is no routine screening. If at all we find a woman who is symptomatic with vaginal discharge, with foul smelling vaginal discharge, with an itchy vaginal discharge, then we will look for bacterial vaginosis, and if we confirm bacterial vaginosis, then we will treat. So symptomatic infection in pregnancy, we will treat. Treatment is done. And if, for instance, there is an asymptomatic infection in pregnancy incidentally identified, asymptomatic infection in pregnancy, we do not treat. Okay, so you understand that bacterial vaginosis treatment requires antibiotic given. You have to give antibiotics to treat that infection. All antibiotics contain have some adherent risks involved when used in pregnancy. So we have to be very cautious whether to use it or not, right? Though bacterial vaginosis is associated with risks of preterm labor, PROM, endometritis in pregnancy, we will not treat all the women of bacterial vaginosis in pregnancy. Otherwise, we would end up treating a lot of women. And whether antibiotic treatment does actually decrease the risk of preterm labor, endometritis or PROM, some studies say yes, some studies say no. So it is kind of controversial. That is why we have come to a middle ground. What is our middle ground? We will not do routine screening for bacterial vaginosis in pregnancy, right? Therefore, less chances of finding asymptomatic infections, all right? So asymptomatic infections are not to be treated. But if a woman is symptomatic, if she has symptoms of bacterial vaginosis and then it is confirmed, you know, by the saline preparations, then we have to treat. So these five points about bacterial vaginosis in pregnancy are worth remembering. Moving on to the next question. In choriocarcinoma, lung metastasis belong to what stage now? So, what staging are they talking about? 1, 2, 3, 4. What are these stages they are talking about? They are talking about the FIGO staging. They are talking about the FIGO staging of choriocarcinoma. And according to the FIGO staging, lung metastasis are stage 3. FIGO staging of choriocarcinoma is a very simple staging. And choriocarcinoma, we know, is the malignancy which arises from the chorionic tissue. It is arising from the trophoblastic tissue. So, it is a component of gestational trophoblastic neoplasia. So, all choriocarcinomas, all gestational trophoblastic neoplasias can be staged according to FIGO also. So, as long as they are confined to the uterus, it is FIGO stage 1. When they moved out of the uterus and they go to the vagina or they go to the tubes or they go to the ovaries, they become stage 2. So, vaginal metastasis of choriocarcinoma is stage 2. Stage 3 is when they have gone to lungs. So, lung metastasis is in stage 3. And stage 4 is other distant metastasis like the brain and the intra-abdominal method, alright, like liver and other abdominal organs. So, in short, uterus stage 1, vagina stage 2, lungs, you might be tempted to think that lung is a distant organ, it should be stage 4. No, with choriocarcinoma, lung metastasis is stage 3 and stage 4 is other distant mets. Next question. This instrument is used in what procedure? Cesarean, for the gills, vaginal, or suction and evacuation. So, maybe if you have not seen the instrument previously, but some kind of guesswork could have worked. This is a big instrument. It is a retractor, as we can see. This is a very special kind of retractor which we do not use in other abdominal surgery. So, surgical other abdominal surgeries we don't use. This is a very specific retractor. This is a Doyen's retractor. And the specifics about this retractor is its shape. The curved shape of this retractor, right? And when this retractor is placed over the symphysis pubis, right? It kind of, what does it do? It is used to push the bladder out of the harm's way. So it is used in a cesarean section. This is specifically retracted, Doyen's retractor finds use, very nice use in the cesarean section. So, like when we are going for a cesarean section and this is the symphysis pubis, if you recall, this is the uterus. This is the uterus here and we have to give an incision here. Let's say we have to give an incision here, but the bladder is also here. Right, the bladder is also here. So, what we do is that we have to push the bladder, remove the bladder, you know, down. You have to push the bladder down, and that is where the Doyen's retractor comes into play. The Doyen's retractor is inserted like this, and bladder is lifted behind the Doyen's retractor, right? So, when we place this retractor over the symphysis pubis, this Doyen's retractor replaces the, pushes the bladder down out of harm's way, and then we can give incision on the lower uterine segment. Now, if we use a retractor which is curved like this, okay, if we use a retractor instead of a Doyen's, if we were to use another retractor which is curved like this, and we have to give an incision here, it is difficult. But since the Doyen's retractor has a curve here, okay, it gives easy access to the lower uterine segment and we can make the incision on the lower uterine segment. So, it is typically used in cesarean section. Fothergill surgery is another name for Manchester repair. Vaginal hysterectomies, such a big retractor will find no use in vaginal surgeries. Similarly, suction and evacuation, where will you use such a huge retractor in suction evacuation? No. So, even if you had not seen, maybe a little guesswork would have worked in your favor, and this was the only abdominal surgery among all these four options. So, cesarean section is your answer. Moving on to the next question. All right, so this question needs some little thinking here, and it pertains to transverse lie. So let us go, let us read the options one by one. A primi gravida at 37 weeks diagnosed to be having transverse lie. Which of the following is correct? Do we need a repeat ultrasound to confirm? What do you say to that? If on clinical examination we have said that it is a transverse lie, which is a very, which is a fairly easy thing to diagnose, head in one hypochondrium and the head to one side and the buttocks to the other side, the pelvic girdle being empty, we don't need a repeat USG to confirm our diagnosis of transverse lie, do we? But if we at all need a USG, yes, we do need a USG for some other thing, to localize the placenta. So we do need a USG to localize the placenta if we don't have a prior, especially if we don't have a prior scan to see where the placenta So a woman who is coming at 37 weeks is likely to have an ultrasound in the second trimester, an anomaly scan, right, which will show us where the placenta is. And if the placenta is already in the upper segment in the earlier scans, it will not become lower segment now, right? So we do not actually need a repeat USG to confirm the diagnosis. But if at all there is no ultrasound available in the course of the pregnancy, no second trimester scan, no other scan, then we might need a USG to localize the placenta. Other than that, repeat USG to confirm the diagnosis is not required. So this is a false statement. Do cesarean section at the onset of labor. Now, at the onset of labor, in early labor, when the os is still closed, when the woman is not getting very good contractions, maybe just mild occasional contractions, when the membranes are still intact, I have told you in the lectures that in transverse lie, one can attempt external cephalic version, you know, at the onset of labor also. Okay, so do cesarean section at the onset of labor. So it's not like, you know, there's a hurry. Okay, transverse lie, os closed, onset of labor, early labor, let's do a cesarean section quickly. No, we still have time, we can wait. And we might want to do an external cephalic version also. So doing cesarean section at the onset of labor by itself is a false statement. Okay, cesarean section at advanced labor is definitely a true statement. So that is another thing. So do cesarean section at the onset of labor is a false statement, because at the onset of labor we have the option of offering an external cephalic version if the criteria for external cephalic version are fulfilled, and of course if the woman is consenting. So at the onset of labor, if the criteria for external cephalic version are not met, yes, of course, we do a cesarean section. If the woman decides that she is not willing for an external cephalic version, then of course we have to go for a cesarean section. So doing cesarean section at the onset of labor by itself is a false statement, because there are certain caveats to it. All right, we can offer, it is not like absolutely we have to do so. We can offer external cephalic version. The woman might choose external cephalic version. And therefore, at the onset of labor, we do not go for a cesarean section straight away. We consider the other options available also. So option two is false statement because of that reason. So you see, understand that doing cesarean section, they've specified onset of labor. Why have they specified onset of labor here? That is to confuse you. All right. So yes, of course, cesarean section is required once the woman becomes 4 centimeter dilated. She is getting good contractions. There is no going back now, and already the os has opened or the membranes are ruptured. She is already leaking. Then in those situations, we can't do external cephalic version. So obviously, we go for a cesarean section only. Right, but since they're specifying onset of labor, that is why the statement is false, because they want you to consider in your head that yes, other possibilities also exist. During cesarean, let's go for the third option. During cesarean, deliver by breech. What do you think happens when we do a cesarean section for transverse sleeve? How do we take out the baby? We have to take out the baby from a lower uterine segment incision. That is a small incision. We can't take out the transverse lie baby like this. Okay? If the baby is in a transverse lie, can you grab the head? The head is a rounded structure lying in one of the hypochondrium. How can you grab the head? Try to grab the head in that Liker space. The head slips from our arms. How do we deliver a baby by cesarean section? In a transverse lie, by grasping the feet, by grasping the buttock, because the buttock does not slip from our hand. So whenever we do a transverse lie cesarean section, okay, if this is the uterus and this is our baby here, these are the feet and the buttocks, all right, we have given an incision here, we introduce our palm. If we try to grasp the fetal head in this situation, in a transverse lie, the head will slip from our hand. We cannot grasp the fetal head. But yes, we can grasp the feet. We can grasp the buttocks. So what do? We grasp the feet and buttocks, pull it towards the incision, make it a breech, and deliver by breech from the lower segment incision. So during cesarean, we deliver by breech. That is true. Fourth option, transverse lie is associated with placenta previa. That is true statement. Transverse lie is associated with placenta previa. In fact, the most common cause of transverse lie at term, is a placenta previa. So yes, option 4 is true. Transverse lie is associated with placenta previa. Admitted 36 weeks. Why do we want to admit these women at 36 weeks? Beyond 36 weeks, these women can go into labor now anytime. If they happen to go to labor at their home, right? And then they take 4 hours, 5 hours, 6 hours or whatever amount of time to reach to the hospital. During that time, their labor might progress. During that time, the os might open. During that time in labor, the membranes might rupture. And then in transverse lie, there is a very high risk of cord prolapse. So ideally, transverse lie women, they should be admitted at 36 weeks for safe confinement, so that such kind of complications do not happen. If the woman is required to come after the onset of labor pains, like women usually do, they come to the labor room when they already are in labor pains, but that we cannot allow in transverse lie. So in transverse lie, we admit them at 36 weeks for safe confinement. That is also true. So what are the options now? False, false, true, true, true. Option B is your correct answer. False, false, true, true, and true. All right. So question number 8, the correct answer is option number B. Moving on to the next question. Anti-D prophylaxis is administered in all of the following conditions except. Okay. MTP at 63 days. They are writing MTP, medical termination of pregnancy. 63 days is 9 weeks. Okay, so pretty advanced, 9 weeks, first trimester MTP. Whether given by medical abortion, whether given by surgical abortion. Anti-D prophylaxis needs to be given. So, MTP, medical termination, whether by drugs or by instrumentation or surgical approach, we have to give anti-D prophylaxis to Rh negative women. Amniocentesis at 16 weeks, invasive procedure, yes, anti-D is required. Manual removal of placenta, invasive procedure, yes, anti-D administration is required. Now, intrauterine transfusion. Intrauterine transfusion is also an invasive procedure, right? So, this could be a confusing element for you people here. So, why are we not giving, why am I answering intrauterine transfusion as my option of not giving anti-D prophylaxis? Because intrauterine transfusion is actually being done in an already isoimmunized pregnancy where the child, where the fetus is already suffering from the consequences of isoimmunization in the form of hemolytic anemias. So, giving anti-D prophylaxis is useless. Why are we giving anti-D prophylaxis? We are giving anti-D prophylaxis. Why are we giving in these conditions? In MTPs, in amniocentesis, in manual removal of placentas, in external cephalic versions, in chorionic villus samplings, in abruption. Why are we giving in certain, in these conditions? What are these conditions? These conditions are the sensitizing events. All these conditions are the sensitizing events. What do you mean by sensitizing events? By sensitizing events, we mean those events which will increase the chances of the mother getting sensitized. That means increase the chances of mother forming antibodies against the Rh antigen. If the mother is carrying an Rh positive fetus and she herself is Rh negative, right? So, sensitizing events, they increase the probability, increase the chances of mother forming Rh antibodies. Mother forming Rh antibodies. That is why these sensitizing events should be covered apart from the routine antenatal anti-D prophylaxis. Okay, all these sensitizing events need to be covered with anti-D administration. But intrauterine transfusion, yes, it is an invasive procedure. But intrauterine transfusion is done for treating the hemolytic anemia, in the fetus. And why does the fetus have this hemolytic anemia? Because the mother has already formed antibodies and those antibodies have already gone into the fetus and led to hemolytic anemia in the fetus. So, the mother in these cases is already isoimmunized, she is already sensitized. So, the mother is already sensitized. Right? So, that is why there is no need of giving intrauterine transfusion. The mother is already sensitized. Alright? So, that is why the answer to this question is option number D. Moving on to the next question, that's the last question. In atonic PPH, which of the following is done? Uterine massage done first. Yes, of course. You are delivering the woman and the placenta is out, the uterus is atonic, your hands are inside the vagina, you are standing there, you will immediately start giving uterine massage, right? So, you're the person who's delivering the baby, you're the person in front of whom the atonic PPH occurs, start with uterine massage. So, this is true. Start with uterine massage. Ergometrine is administered to all. Is it to all? Don't we know that contraindications to ergometrine exist? So endometrine is not administered to all. Ergometrine has a long list of contraindications like preeclampsia, eclampsia, heart disease, right? Rh negative woman. So ergometrine is not administered to all women with atonic PPH. There are contraindications to ergometrine that exist, like hypertensive diseases, preeclampsias, eclampsias, heart diseases, Rh negative mother. In these cases, we don't give ergometrine. B Lynch if medical management fails. Medical management is all the uterotonics that we've given. We've given oxytocin, we've given misoprostol, we've given carboprost. We might have given ergometrine if the contraindications were not there. So we have exhausted the medical management options. Then we have to move on to B-Lynch suture. It is a compression suture. Okay, it is a compression suture. So yes, B-Lynch is given if medical management fails. What about suction of the uterus? Suction of the uterus. What do you think? Suction of the uterus. Anyway, suction is not mentioned in any of the options. But let me tell you that maybe 30-40 years ago, suction of uterus was done. But imagine there is a big atonic uterus and you are standing with a very small suction apparatus and the postpartum uterus is very soft. Suction of the uterus at this stage can cause, if you are thinking that we will do suction and the uterus is going to contract, nope. It doesn't happen. It doesn't happen. In fact, it can lead to more dangers like, you know, rupture of the uterus. So, suction of the uterus is dangerous in this situation. So, suction does not work in atonic PPH, right? So, this is also false. So, what is your correct answer? Your correct answer is A and C are correct. Option number A and C are the correct options. All right. So this finishes the discussion of the 10 questions that were asked in the latest AIIMS. And what I have gathered from this AIIMS paper is that they have asked you nothing. No new topic has been asked. All the old topics have been asked. Little more on the clinical side has been asked. And that is what we always expect from AIIMS, right? So I hope this discussion has been helpful.